Hi, welcome to the signal path. Well, what are we looking at? This is a grating diffraction mirror. And what that does is that it's able to separate wavelengths into its individual components, a particular polychromatic wavelength into its individual components. And if I bring it close to the light, you can see how the light above the camera, the wavelengths are spread out, and you can clearly see the different colors in the camera. So why am I showing you this? Well, because this episode is all about a monochromator that I have modified and made it into a scanning monochromator with all the different stepper motors and circuits that go around it. But before we get into that, let me just explain to you how this whole thing works. And I think there's a lot of really interesting and fascinating things to learn about monochromators. When I was a student at university, I used to use one for some experiments in the photonics group at University of Toronto. And I learned quite a bit about it many years ago, so let me tell you all about it. So let's talk a little bit about monochromators. So let's think about a very, very simple thing we want to do. We are interested in separating the wavelengths of light into different components so that we can look at each individual wavelength separately and then measure the amount of power, the amount of energy that is in that wavelength, so that which would, of course, then correspond to how intense that wavelength is, and then we can get wavelength composition of a polychromatic type of light that's coming at us. So I'm mostly interested in the visible range because that's cool. You can look at it, you can see it. But of course, you can make monochromators in the UV and in the IR quite easily. Once you go outside of that, and then you have microwaves and other X-rays and so on, then there are different techniques that can come into play that I'm not going to cover in this video, perhaps in a different video. So how does this grating diffraction mirror that I showed you actually work? So it doesn't have to actually be a mirror. It can just be a transparent piece of film with a particular number of slits in it. The distance between the slits is going to determine how it interacts with different wavelengths. And I don't want to go into too much detail because it's a lot of geometry and algebra to come out of this equation, but to give you a basic idea, it works by the fact that imagine you have a reflective surface. This is a grating mirror and not a slit film, but you have a reflective surface and you have an incident wave that is coming towards it. Of course, the wave is going to reflect off of that surface. But because it has this grating pattern, and this grating pattern has a particular distance between each grating, that distance is important. The wave is going to reflect off of two surfaces. But because of the distance between those two, it's going to have a particular extra length of distance that it has to travel at a particular incident plane. And that means that if the distances between the gratings is comparable to the wavelength in some way, then by following through the algebra and so on, you can actually produce constructive and destructive interference patterns. And that constructive and destructive interference patterns is going to depend on not just distance d, but it's going to also depend on lambda, because it is the lambda that's going to determine whether two waves are going to act constructively or destructively, because their phase has to line up. So based on all of these things together, this grating mirror is going to be able to produce constructive and destructive patterns whose location is going to depend on the wavelength. As a result, depending on which angle you're looking at this grating mirror, you're going to see a different wavelength at its highest intensity, because that's going to be the wavelength that's going to have constructive interference, and all the other ones are going to have destructive interferences. As a result of that, by shining a polychromatic wave light onto a surface of a grating mirror, you're going to be able to diffract the light as a function of angle with respect to the surface of the grating mirror and separate the light into its individual wavelength components. And I encourage you to go ahead and read more about this to convince yourself that you really fully understand this. And like I said, it doesn't have to be a mirror. It can just simply be a film that has a whole bunch of slits in it. And just remember that what is important is that is the number of slits, the distance between the slits, the wavelength, and the angle is going to give you this equation that you see up here. And as a result, and this equation, because it is a function of wavelength, is going to allow you to create this dispersion as a function of angle and then look at the different wavelengths at a particular angle coming from the diffraction mirror. And that's why this is so useful, because you can split the wavelength, split the light into its individual components. Well, there is one other thing that we know very readily, we learn as kids, that can do this, and that is, of course, a prism. But the prism does dispersion, accomplishes dispersion in an entirely different mechanism. It's really important and interesting to note that the way a prism works, dispersion in a prism, is a very different phenomenon. So the way a prism operates is that light is going to go from a medium that has a totally different density and totally different dielectric constant as a result into a medium that has a very different density. This transition between low density to high density is going to have a different index of refraction. So this is a process of refraction, a very different phenomenon. When light goes from a low density environment into a high density environment, actually slows down and it bends due to a refraction angle, and that angle is a function of wavelength itself. So the angle of light, the range in which the light bends is going to depend on wavelength, and that wavelength, and because of that, the light is going to separate into its individual components. And once again, once it enters, comes out of that medium, it's going to bend yet again. And once it bends yet again, you're going to get the light further separated from each other. So if I look in here, depending on the angle that I look, I'm going to see a different light. Even though this is doing dispersion, ultimately this is dispersing light, it's a very, very different phenomenon as the other one. This depends on refraction. The index of refraction between the materials depends on slowing the light down, the speed of light, by going through a different medium. This is not how a grating mirror works. A grating mirror works by constructive and destructive interferences depending on the angle and the distance between the grating. A completely different phenomenon, but with very, very similar results. So you may ask, then why not use a prism in a monochromator? Well, I guess you could, but the grating mirror has many advantages because you can change its property by manufacturing different grating spacing and other, you know, other advantages. It can be very precise and so on, which is why prisms are typically not used, at least as far as I know. But if you know of an example, please let me know. And this is how the dispersion happens in a prism. One other note about this refraction phenomena is that this is why diamonds shine and glow, and well, they don't glow, but they look so sparkly. It's because the index of refraction of diamond is so high. So when the light enters the diamond, it rotates many, many times before it can get out, and it creates all these weird internal refractions and reflections, and that is what causes the diamond to look so sparkly. So it's just the secret is in the incredibly high index of refraction of diamond. Well, having said all of that, well, how does a monochromator work? Well, now we pretty much have all the components to build one. So we have a light source, and here's you can see a polychromatic light source here, and the light then comes in here, and it's going to hit a collimating mirror in order to create a very straight angles, hitting a diffraction grating mirror. And once it hits the diffraction grating mirror, as I explained earlier, it's going to break apart into its individual wavelength components, and they're going to come out at a different angle. And once, and we're going to kind of hit that to a focusing mirror. And now, depending on how I rotate this mirror, and I create another exit slit here, a different wavelength is going to come out of this slit. So if I want to, and if I know this angle, if I know the number of slits per millimeter of the grating mirror, if I know the distances of all the mirrors, you can calculate exactly what wavelength you expect to come out of this slit. And by moving this, we can scan through all of the different wavelengths, and there you go. Then you're going to have a monochromator. It's kind of a monochromator because you can look at only a single wavelength at a time, the one that's coming out of this slit. So for example, here, this detector is looking at the green light. But if I turn this mirror a little bit, then a different light is going to come out of this slit, and we can measure it. And by scanning this, we're going to be able to create a graph of wavelength as a function of power that this light is made of. Well, the last thing to talk about is the detector. How are we going to make a detector? Well, you can make a detector from many, many different ways. You can make solid-state detectors like silicon-germanium diodes, or you can make some kind of a p-n junction, or some kind of a 3-5 material, even a phosphide material, and so on, to create a detector. And people do that. But in order to, for a monochromator, you don't really want to do that. And the reason is because those type of detectors don't have a very high sensitivity. Their quantum efficiency is rather limited. As a result of that, they're not able to give you a lot of current as a function of in the photons that hit the junction, for example. That's essentially means that their conversion from photons to their photoelectric behavior is not as good as you want it to be. What if I want to count only a single photon? That's kind of hopeless with a semiconductor because this noise will completely overwhelm anything you're trying to measure. So that's not going to work. So we're going to use a totally different component, which is actually not a solid state component, and it's one of the only vacuum tube type structures that is still quite relevant, although you see them used in audio equipment and so on, but generally vacuum tubes are essentially obsolete, but a photomultiplier is not. So what is a photomultiplier? So as the name suggests, a photomultiplier is a way of multiplying the number of photons. So this name is a little bit misleading, and I'll talk about why. So imagine that this is the structure of a photomultiplier. Imagine I have some high energy photon that I'm interested in measuring and being able to detect. And this is going to go through a scintillator, and that's going to, you know, convert it to a low energy photon. Let's not worry about that. Let's imagine our high energy photon hitting a photocathode. And what the photocathode is going to do is going to convert our single photon to an electron or multiple electrons. So if an electron is going to come out of the photocathode, now we have an electron that we want to measure. Of course, measuring a single electron is also quite difficult. So the only way we can measure it is somehow by multiplying it. So this process of converting a photon into an electron is kind of the opposite of what happens in, you know, in the old cathode ray televisions, because there you're converting electrons into photons, so you can look at them from the outside of the screen. This is the exact opposite of that phenomena. It's interesting to note that. So a photon comes in, turns into an electron. Then these electrons are going to go through a series of dynodes, which are essentially plates that are charged with different amounts of potential. So how does that work? Well, imagine that each of these plates have increasing potential on them. So let's say this is 100 volts, 200, 300, 400, 500. What does that do? It means that there's going to be always an electric field in a particular direction between the two nodes because they have a different potential. That electric field, which is actually in the opposite direction of the electron moving, if I'm not mistaken, correct me if I'm wrong on that, it's been a long time since I've thought about this. So the electron wants to move in that direction because of the difference in the charge between the plates. But these plates are charged positively, so they want to absorb the electron. So the electron is going to move toward the dynode, it's going to hit the dynode with a very high energy because it's going to get energy by traveling through the electric field. Once it hits the dynode, is some phenomena called secondary emission happens, and then that single high energy electron is going to hit that surface and it's going to bounce back as multiple electrons with lower amount of energy. So nothing magic, no magic is happening here. We're not breaking laws of thermodynamics. We are simply converting a high energy electron to multiple low energy electrons. So now you have more electrons than you started with. Those multiple low energy electrons are now going to get attracted to the second dynode, and that second dynode is going to absorb them and attract them again, because remember, the potential continues to increase, so the electric field is maintained. As a result of that, they're going to accelerate to the second dynode and they're going to get more energy. They're going to hit the second dynode with more energy again, but now there is multiple of them and they're going to do another secondary emission with even more electrons. So now you get the idea. As these electrons bounce against the dynodes at secondary emission, they're going to get more and more and more electrons. By the time they reach the anode, the final plate, there's many, many electrons. And what does many, many electrons mean? It means more current. So essentially, this is an amplification of the current that you're going to get at the end. And you can have, you know, a factor of a million amplification. You can detect a single photon really, really easily. And there is one of these photomultiplier vacuum tubes inside the monochromator that I just showed you, the Verity monochromator. And this is why I was so happy to find all of that package for such a cheap price, because everything is already built in and taken care of. This, of course, needs, you know, multiple high voltage power supplies and has to be all properly biased and all. So, you know, it's a lot of work. It's good to have that all available and ready. So there it is. You know, you now put a photo multiplier in here, and voila, you got yourself a monochromator. I hope that my explanation made sense to you. Of course, leave a comment if you have any questions, and we can go from there. And I apologize if I said something wrong and this is not scripted, so I'm just explaining it on top of my head. But point out if I made a mistake along the way, and we can discuss it. So let's go ahead and look and see what the modifications that I've made to the monochromator. So here's a monochromator that I picked up from eBay, and I actually bought two of these. And you wouldn't believe it, I paid less than $100 for two of them. It's just crazy. I'm really happy about this find, considering what's in here. This is a full monochromator with everything, including the dial, as well as all the circuitry that goes inside it, the high voltage power supply, the photomultiplier. Everything is in here. It's a fully complete unit, and it's functional too. I tested them, both of them were good. And I'm going to show you what's inside it and the modification that I made to the other one. So we'll go over it, but I wanted to show you this. This is a Verity instrument monochromator, which can measure from 200 nanometer to 950 nanometers. So it covers much more than the visible range, from ultraviolet to the infrared range. So pretty awesome. Let's go ahead and take a look at it. So let's take a look at this monochromator before I put it all together, because it will be very difficult to take the top cover off afterwards. So this this thing that you see here, this micro positioner, is not part of the instrument. I've added this myself, and I'll explain to you why. So you can see this is really nice and portable. One of the things I wanted to do is that I didn't want to make any modifications to this, which would increase its kind of footprint. I didn't want to have something resting on the table. I wanted to all be contained and attached to the unit itself. So I and I brainstormed a whole different type of ways to do this. But let's take a look inside it, and then we'll figure out what I plan to do. Here we go. So this, the principle of operation of the monochromator, as I explained just before, it should be fairly obvious to figure out how this one works. And you can see that, I'll show you different angles of this, but on the right side here, there is a little slit, and that's a 500 micron slit, which will determine the bandpass response of this, as well as ensuring that the wave will come in perpendicular forward. So the light enters this way, it will bounce off this mirror, and then it will hit this other mirror, which is a grating mirror. This is the one that has the particular number of slits per millimeter, as I described earlier, and it will separate all the wavelengths in kind of like a rainbow pattern. So the waveform that the wavelength that hits here, that will match the particular angle of this lens here, will then hit the second mirror, and then the third mirror in here, and then finally will enter this photomultiplier unit that I described also in here. So you can imagine that by changing the angle of this mirror, you're able to have an exact incident wavelength to travel through these other mirrors. If the angle is off, the other wavelengths will just hit other parts of the instrument, won't be absorbed to the black body of the instrument itself, and it won't reflect anywhere else anymore. But a precise, particular wavelength that matches the exact angle, depending on the slit and so on, will then make its way down to the photomultiplier. So this thing is rather heavy, as it should be, because it's a free space optic piece, and I have to make sure that you don't touch any of these components on the inside, because if you even shift them by a little bit, of course the calibration is out the door, and any modification that I made to it, I try to make sure as much as possible not to damage the unit itself, and not to make sure not to touch any of the components on this side, which was quite difficult actually. So you can see that here's the photomultiplier unit, and at the high voltage input of the photomultiplier, we have they have put a silicon glue there to make sure that you don't accidentally touch it and electrocute yourself. Here's the high voltage power supply. The high voltage power supply can go down to -1000 volts, and all the circuitry that handles all the analog circuitry that collects the voltage from the photomultiplier and also interfaces the photomultiplier to the front panel and so on is all underneath. Here you can see it at the bottom there, and let me show you quickly how you can adjust the wavelength. And this is the reason why I wanted to get the manual one as opposed to the automatic one. They actually have one of these models that has a stepper motor already attached, but it doesn't have this micrometer here, and which then prevents you from knowing what the wavelength is, because you have to know what the calibration coefficients are for the stepper motor and so on, which of course I didn't have. So I opted to go with this one. So you can see that as I turn this, and you can actually read the wavelength directly off of that. You can see that the mirror, this grating mirror, will rotate, and as the grating mirror will rotate, you're able to select a particular wavelength. Now this micrometer goes from about 100 nanometer all the way to 900, but the limitations of what I've added is going to limit us from 225 to about 875 nanometer, which is almost a full range, which is fine. So I had a whole bunch of different ideas on how to do this, maybe attach something, some kind of a gear to this, or some kind of a band, like an elastic band to it to attach it to a motor, but all of those wasn't very precise. So ultimately I came up with this solution. So this is nothing more than a machine piece of aluminum that has that's hollow inside, which will fit around this, and then has a shaft that will come outside of the unit, and it has this little conversion unit which converts from the thickness of the shaft to a standard 5mm for a stepper motor. And also this has a major advantage, and you can see because of the slits that are incorporated into it, it has some degree of freedom to rotate in this direction. And this is useful because there is no way that I can get this thing to be perfectly straight. So as this thing rotates, there's going to be a tiny amount of wobble, and that wobble will then be absorbed by these springy behavior of this connector between these two, and not put too much strain on the micrometer, because this is extremely precise. It's perfectly straight. You know, it's very, very smooth. This is a precision instrument, as you can imagine. So as a result of that, I cannot put any strain on it, otherwise I'm gonna slowly damage it and slowly lose the calibration. So this should do that. And look at this. You know, I put this in here. Look, it fits so nicely around that. And you know, kind of our starting position is here, depending on the thickness. There we go, roughly around here, I think, is where we can start. So as I rotate this, and there's a little screws in here which I can tighten. I'll show you that. You can see that as I rotate this from the outside, now it's going to turn the micrometer and so on. So let me show you. There we go. So it's got little tiny holes in it where tiny, tiny screws can go in and hug this and make sure that it makes a good, nice, solid connection. So of course I had to go ahead and cut a little window opening here, and that little window opening is going to allow the little shaft to come outside of the unit. So let me show you. This is quite heavy. There we go. There it is. So you can see I've cut this. There's a little bit of an injury, and I'm going to have to blame that on the Dremel tool, because I know I had to do all this by hand. You know, I don't usually complain about tools or anything like that, but I have to say that this thing, let me turn the camera towards it, that Dremel stand over there, that is one of the worst tools I have ever used. That thing does not fit together very well. It's all plastic. It's unsafe. Things just fall apart. Ah, I had a really frustrating time with it. Anyhow, so you can see here the grading mirror. You can in fact see some of the color grading right on it, depending on the angle with the camera. So you can see, you know, you can see exactly what I'm talking about. So. Yes, and in the front panel here, you know, it has a 9-pin connector, and the pinouts for this are thankfully available from the datasheet of this part. There's a little few buttons here to set the bandwidth, the electrical bandwidth of the detector inside, and a kind of bunch of potentiometers for some calibrations and so on. And some external signals are taken out, which are actually available directly on here. Anyway, so here's the window that I cut out. That's it. And from the instrument itself, it's pretty straightforward. So that's what we're going to use, like so, to make a connection. And this is going to connect to our stepper motor. And here's what I have created for the stepper motor. Take a look at this. So here's the little construction that I made. So this has an L-band here, which connects to the motor. So the motor obviously turns here. And on the top, it's connected to a sliding platform, which I just picked up from eBay. So this sliding platform can go forward and backward. And why is that necessary? Well, because this, as I rotate this micrometer, it's actually the distance is going to change. It's going to shift out. So whatever I connect to the end of this, the stepper motor has to be able to travel with this back and forth, otherwise of course it's not going to work. And this is the reason why I have designed this little section here to be able to go back and forth. So this is going to be connected to this guy like this, and it's going to be held up here. So as the whole mechanism moves forward and backwards, since this point is fixed, the motor is basically going to travel along this, and it's going to accomplish what it needs to. So, you know, this is my solution to this problem. There are many other ways to do this, of course, and the end of the stepper motor is connected to a stepper motor drive, and I'll show you the PCB in just a second. So there it is. So now I have to find a way to attach this to the body of the monochromator, and that's what you saw earlier, and that's what this thing is. Again, because I have machined all of these by hand, you know, I've cut all these by hand and put all these screws and bend all these by hand, it's not going to be perfect. I have to have some way of getting some kind of adjustment when I put it together, and that's why I put this micro positioner here. I've screwed this micro positioner to the body here, and it has 3 degrees of freedom. It can move forward and backwards, you know, this way and up and down, and this allows me to align the stepper motor perfectly once I put this all together. So, you know, this is going to go on top, you know, it's going to get screwed down and so on, and this is going to go in here, and this is going to, you know, get attached to that, like that. So then if I'm a little bit off in alignment, I can do a bit of adjustment before I tighten everything up, and that's it. And so as the motor turns, it's going to turn the micrometer, it's going to go move forward and backward, and everything is supposed to work together. I hope. I mean, I haven't actually tried it all together yet. I think it fits together reasonably well. But yeah, this is my solution. As far as the PCB, I just threw something together for a prototype, basically. And what it does is just based on a microcontroller. This is a PIC18F4550. And I have all the cables necessary to connect to the 9-pin header of this. So the interface from the PCB to the monochromator is going to be through this connector. And it has a little LCD screen here that shows the high voltage power supply that's internally inside the monochromator, so I can monitor the photomultiplier's voltage. It has a little potentiometer where I can adjust the photomultiplier. That's going to essentially change the gain of the photomultiplier. And I've equipped it with a little Bluetooth module. So this is a wireless monochromator. So it's going to wirelessly transmit the data it reads to the computer, so I don't have to connect it to the computer directly, which is convenient because you may have this across the lab or something. And, you know, it connects to a power supply via this. So it needs plus and minus 15 volts. So you give it plus and minus 15 volts. This is just for programming port. This will come off afterwards. And the this guy is just going to sit directly up here as based on this is headers that it has. So it's all, you know, taken care of. Now the question is, you know, write some software for it and have it communicate with the computer. So let me go ahead and I kind of close this up and put it all together, and so we can see how it works. Well, check out the final product. I think it turned out really, really well. So here are the both of the monochromators. They're on top of each other. So the bottom one is still in manual because he still has the micrometer, you know, not connected to anything. As I showed you the bits and pieces of the other monochromator, you can see that I've already assembled it and all connected together. And I think it looks pretty good. So let me take this camera off so we can take a closer look at this, and I'll do my best to keep the camera as steady as I can. So let's take a close look here. You can see that, here we go. You can see that here's the first one. You know, you can very, very easily and smoothly rotate. This is already at its minimum setting, and you can see the other one and the way it is connected to the stepper motor. Here's that little shaft that I've created that is now hugging the micrometer, and I've screwed it all down together so it's pretty nice and steady, and this is perfectly straight as it could be. And here is the transition to the stepper motor, as I showed you before, and right now it's not powered, and it is really, really smooth. It works really well. And because of the limitations of these bits and pieces that are machined, this is the minimum that I can achieve. So it's going to start at 225 nanometer. And the way you read this, if you haven't seen this before, is there, or if you've ever owned a caliper, for example, the old, good old analog manual calipers, this is what you would read. So you can see that each rotation of this micrometer has 25 numbers on it. So you can see I'm going backwards now. So here it is, you know, here's 0, here's 5, here's 10, 15, 20, and 25 goes here. And every time this thing makes one rotation, the other section advances by one division. So 4 rotation will be 100 nanometers. So you can see that it advanced from the first to the second division there. So if I go back again, it will go back to exactly where it was, like so. So this is our starting point. And I can go all the way out to 875 nanometer, and this whole thing will be, this stepper motor configuration supports that. You can see it's all the way at the very, very beginning of this. And as I rotate this, this piece will move out, and that's why the stepper motor obviously has to be on rails, because it has to be able to move back and forth in order to support the micrometer going back and forth. So it turned out really well, and you can see here the micro positioner is essentially pretty much at its default position. I didn't have to really turn it very much. It already aligned really, really well. So I'm pretty happy with it. Of course, we're going to see it in action. And up here, you can see the stepper motor is as a ferrite core that I added to the wires just to, you know, subdue some of the EM emissions that can come from rapid increase in current that can happen in the coils. And here it is, the stepper motor controller and the little board that I put together. Nothing fancy. Here's the Bluetooth module, which of course you can take off and replace with a wired connection if you want to, but the wireless, you know, is convenient, and so on. And here's the display that will read the photomultiplier current, microcontroller and everything, as I showed you before. So it's pretty nice and compact. And of course, I have two of these monochromators, so what can be done is that you can disconnect the 9-pin connector from here and then connect it to the bottom one. Now you have a perfectly manual monochromator as opposed to an automatic one, and I can just go ahead and kind of connect it to the top one again, like so. I have to push it in there, and then you can read it from that. And the next step would be to create a board that has two interfaces. You can simultaneously power both of them. One of them would be manual, the other one would be automatic. And one other thing you can add is that you can add a potentiometer somewhere in here, which can read the position to you and then tell you where you are. But I've tried going back and forth on this with the stepper motor many, many, many times, and it always goes back to exactly the same place. It's very precise. This stepper motor has 200 steps per revolution, but the stepper motor driver board does 1/8 steps. That means that would be 600 steps per revolution. And you can, you know, figure out what that means in nanometers and so on. So it's pretty straightforward, really easy to control. And I can change the photomultiplier's current by changing the potentiometer, the potentiometer, and that allows me to change the gain of the photomultiplier. So if the light is really bright, or I have too many photons already, and I don't need so much gain from the photomultiplier, in order to avoid saturating it, you can turn down the dial and get less voltage, and you can read the voltage live in here from the monitoring port of the instrument itself. So, you know, it looks really good. And here's the two inputs to both of the monochromators. You can see I've attached to two pieces of fiber that they came with the units when I bought them, and they come into here, and this is one of them. This is the one to the manual one. You can see that it has a bunch of fibers at its input, so you can couple light to it very easily. And the other one here, I have attached a white piece of paper to it. Now, it will become apparent why I've done this. I will take this away when we're going to measure other things, but for our first experiment, I've added this as a diffusive element, and also to attenuate the light that's coming in, because I know I'm going to look at a very, very narrow wavelength in order to find out if this thing is working. And that's why I've added that. It will become apparent in just a few moments. So let's go ahead and turn it on. Okay, we're ready for experiment, so let's go ahead and power this thing on. The monochromator can be powered on from a simple plus or minus 15 volt supply. So I'm going to go ahead and turn the supply on like that, and you can see that the different various power consumption is burning 258 milliamp from 15 volts and 71 milliamps from minus 15 volts. The majority of the plus 15 volt current is coming from the stepper motor, which is now engaged. So it's no longer free to rotate on its own. So let's go ahead and take a look and see what happens here. And what I've done here is that I've also removed the Bluetooth, and I've replaced it with an FTDI card here, which are all pin compatible, because I'm going to connect this to my desktop, and my desktop does not have a Bluetooth interface on it. So you can see that this is minus 5 volts. That's the voltage on the photomultipliers. You have to scale that by a factor of 100, 10 millivolts per volt. So it's minus 5 means minus 500, and I can adjust that. For example, see, I can go down to reduce the gain of the system, or I can go up to increase the gain of the system, and I can go in all the way up to minus 10 volts. I think 1,000 volts is the maximum for this. So there you go. It's pretty easy and straightforward, and you can see the LED is blinking, which means it's waiting for the computer to initiate a scan. So in order for me to do that, the very first thing I wanted to do is just do, you know, a basic dark run where there is no signal going into it, and I'm going to do that by simply covering the detector with, you know, a very dark surface like that. So now it's covered, so hopefully there's no stray light. There might be a little bit, but probably not so much enough right now, because the voltage of the photomultiplier is only at minus 500, so the gain is reasonably low. So I'm going to go ahead and do a sweep, and then I'll show you the code on MATLAB. But first, I just wanted to show you the mechanics of this thing moving around. So let me just give you a very brief overview of what the code inside the microcontroller is doing, so that it doesn't seem overwhelming, because it's actually really simple and straightforward. What I've done is that first, I've created a function called step motor and another function called revolution motor. And these two functions, all they do is that they go in a certain number of predefined steps that I have told the program to advance the motor in the direction that I want. So step motor has one variable called unit step, and this is how many microsteps, how many 1/1600th of a full revolution step I want the motor to take between each measurement, because I don't want to go at 1/1600th of a revolution every single measurement, because that's just really, really fine steps. And I may not be interested in such a fine wavelength measurement. So what I've done is that I've chosen unit step to be a number of steps equivalent to 0.5 nanometer wavelength. That's kind of what I'm going with, you know, to do measurement. You can adjust, easily adjustable. The revolution motor will do one revolution of the stepper motor every time you call that. And this is useful for bringing the motor back to its initial position, so that it just rapidly comes back. You know, you don't have to call that unusual number of steps and so on. So you just program how many steps per revolution, and then you just tell it which direction to go. So that's so far straightforward. The next function is that the read signal function, and all this function does is that it reads a value from the analog to digital converter of the microcontroller, which is a 10-bit converter, and it's going to digitize from 0 to 5 volts steps. So it's about, you know, 5 divided by 1024. That's the step size in volts. And that is just going to return the value back to us. And this is a 16-bit integer, because, you know, it's a more than 8-bit, so you have to define a 16-bit integer. So really, really straightforward three functions. Next, the main function begins. And here in the main function, I define a couple of constants. Oop, I'm sorry, I don't think I was showing that. Here we go. So there it is. The main function begins here. And at the beginning of that, I just define a couple of constants and, you know, telling it what the start wavelength is, what the stop wavelength is, and also a couple of other things. It calculates the total number of revolution, the total number of steps, and so on. Just some constants so the program can work with. And then the program waits for a character to appear from the serial port. And while it's waiting, it's just going to blink the LED back and forth. This basically means that the unit is ready, and it's going to start scanning when the computer is ready to receive the data. Because once it starts scanning, then it's just going to continue sending serial characters out to the computer, and the computer is supposed to take that and plot it and deal with it mathematically in order to give you a nice graph. And then this thing actually has two modes of operation. That's just a minor detail, not really important. You don't need to have two modes of operation. But it has two modes, because in one mode, it just spits out values without advancing the motor. That would be for when the monochromator is in manual mode, at the bottom of the bottom unit, for example. And then the other mode is that it will actually advance the motor every time it wants to create a new measurement. So for example, here, this for loop here is going to do that. So it's going to calculate the current wavelength, and it's going to determine the current value by reading the signal from the ATD converter, and then it's going to step the motor once, and then have a little delay, and then continue the function forward. So then if I go back to the next page, here you go, it's the last bit of the code, and what it's going to do is that once it is fully finished, then it's going to then go ahead and bring the motor back the number of revolutions necessary to put it back into its default position, which is 225 nanometers. So you can see that the code is actually really, really easy and really, really straightforward. I can put this on the website if you're interested to have it and take a look at it. It's really easy. The Matlab code is similarly straightforward. That one's really not worth showing you, because it's just getting a bunch of serial characters from the serial port and then creating a nice plot which, you know, has the colors in it and looks nice for the computer. But that's really easy. Here we go, we are ready. I'm going to initiate the scan from the computer. And look at that. So it's just very, very slowly scanning, and there's a plot that's being developed on the computer which I can show you later. But for now, I just wanted to focus on the mechanism. You can see that the stepper motor is ever so slowly moving out. You can see it, you know, clearly here now how much further this point is. And there it is, you know, it's scanning. It's going to stop at 875. Right now it's almost at 600. There it is. So I'm going to, once it starts scanning back, when it's done completely, I'll focus in so you can see how precisely it will stop exactly where it started. I'm simply counting steps. I have no feedback mechanism of actually detecting it. There it is, and it's almost done. That's 850, and there it is, 875. There you go. Look at that. And it's going to just stop exactly where it is supposed to. It's just beautiful. Look at that, that's amazing. That's awesome. I did this many, many times. It never ceases to amaze me. Even though, you know, stepper motors are pretty straightforward. There it is. So now I did a full scan on the computer. I will show you the plot that is fairly flat, which means there is very little stray light. And here again, I apologize for filming the screen. It's just very quickly. So this is the Matlab code that I've written. It's just all it does. It does the fancy plotting and all that. And I found some useful information online for creating colorful plots, which was rather straightforward. And there it is. You can see that, let me zoom in here because it's a little bit easier to see it that way. There it is. You can see it plots measured intensity versus wavelength, and here's the intensity. This is a digital world that's coming from the ADC. It doesn't mean anything yet. And the wavelength in nanometer, you can see the plot is colored according to the wavelength. And when it's black, it's outside the visible range for the human eye. And as a result, that's just black, basically, so we can see something. And then you can see ultraviolet, blue, you know, green, yellow, and red, and so on. And you can see a tiny dip here, which is just above zero, and that is simply because of whatever stray light that's making its way inside the little box that I put on top of the fiber optic input. And if I were to crank up the voltage on the photomultiplier, it's going to show higher peaks, which is just from the ambient light that's in my room. And aside from that, the other thing is there's something still missing from this whole system, which I haven't mentioned, and I'm sure many of you have already guessed. What I do not have is that I do not have the photomultipliers quantum efficiency, as well as the photomultipliers wavelength response, so that I can correct this as a function of wavelength, because the photomultiplier is not going to have exactly the same response versus wavelength, because the energy of the photon is different, and so on and on. So as a result, you need to correct the curve that you get and multiply it by the inverse of the sensitivity curve of the photomultiplier. And I don't have that because I'm not exactly sure what photomultiplier is in yet. I haven't investigated it, but if you know, let me know, send me that information, I'll update the code. But it's not, but it's something to keep in mind. Right now, we're not going to rely on the exact value. We just want to look at presence of different wavelengths, which would be exciting. So how do I know this actually works? Well, one easy way to do that is by measuring something that we already know really well. And that is going to be a helium neon laser. Now, helium neon laser is at 632.8 nanometer. It has a really, really small line width. This is not a solid state laser. You could also use a solid state laser with a reasonably good line width as well. But the advantage of using a helium neon laser here is that because this wavelength is simply determined by the properties of the atoms of the gas that's inside it, it's very, very precisely known as a material property. So we can easily go ahead and use that and see if we read, you know, 632.8 or something really, really close to it. Most likely we're not going to read 632.8, it's going to be rounded to the next 0.5 nanometer value, because my the way I've programmed the monochromator, it takes 0.5 nanometer steps. But that's okay. So I'm going to go ahead and turn this on and shine it on the piece of paper. And this is the reason why I had the paper, because the laser is so extremely bright, and I'm using several layers of white paper there to attenuate and disperse the light so that I can measure, you know, a lower amount of photons entering the unit. As I said again, you don't want to use the paper when you're measuring something that's polychromatic with multiple wavelengths in it, because even though the paper looks white, it's not actually completely white, and its transmission properties of different wavelengths is not going to be flat. It's not a ND filter where you can, you know that the attenuation across all the wavelengths is exactly the same. Certainly, I certainly don't know what is attenuation would be outside the visible range. It may look completely different in ultraviolet or in infrared. Anyhow, so we'll remove it when we're measuring other things. But for now, it will serve our purposes really well. So I think I'm going to have to put that on its side. And I already found something to give us a bit of an alignment. And it's all plugged in. Sorry, I'm doing this with one hand here. Let me go get my other hand in there. There it is. And here's our red light, which I'm sure, hopefully, you can see. Let me go zoom into a little bit more. I don't know if you can see that, but it's definitely a really, really bright red dot in there, which is saturating the CCD sensor. So there you go. So let's go ahead, and I'm going to put the box back on top of it, and let's run it and see if we see the wavelength we expect. All right, let's go ahead and run this one more time. Now I have the laser pointing at the piece of paper. It's all turned on, ready to go. There we go. I'm going to run this, and you can see that here, I'm going to lower just a little bit for you so you can see. You can see that it is now sweeping, and it's kind of moving forward along at the bottom with the wavelength, and it's scanning, and it doesn't see anything yet because, of course, it hasn't reached at the wavelength of the laser. We're expecting something to show up after 632 nanometers or so. Here we go, it should show up anytime. Aha, there it is, look at that. That is a nice peak. And once the code, once the whole thing runs, it's going to change color. I don't draw it well with the color because it's going to be too slow the way I'm doing the drawing. So let's see what happens. There we go. Now it's going to change color. Aha, look at that. That is a nice plot. Oops. Sorry, here we go. Look at this. This is a really, really sharp response that we see from the wavelength. As to be expected from a helium neon laser, you're expecting this to be very, very sharp and very, very a narrow width, because it's such a pure tone, such a monochromatic tone. So let's go ahead and put a little marker in here and read the value, and look at that. Look at that value. 633 nanometer, which is rounded to the nearest 0.5 increment of the wavelength in nanometer. It should be 632.8, and I'm sure if I go ahead and reduce the step sizes and scan it even slower, it will tell me exactly 632.8, which is really amazing. Look at that, it works perfectly. I'm really, really happy with it. There's a little bit of stray light here at the bottom. That's just because I couldn't cover it perfectly with the box. So, looks great, looks amazing. Well, now that we have this and it's working really well, let's go ahead and measure a couple of different components that we use all the time, various diodes of different wavelengths and, you know, different kind of light sources. It should be interesting to look at the wavelength composition of a few different types of sources. So let's start measuring something simple. This is an incandescent light source. It's actually on, but it's difficult to tell. Maybe if this can focus, let me turn some light sources off in the room, see if you can see it better. It's really, really dim, but it is indeed turned on, as you can see. And it's, you know, very orangish, reddish kind of color, but it's going to be rather broad spectrum, because it's coming from the, you know, the tungsten filament, and it's going to have a broad spectrum. But also, but depending on the voltage I give this, it's actually special content can change. So because in order not to saturate the photomultiplier, I'm going to go ahead and use it as it is, and I'm going to just place it at the input, like so, facing the photomultiplier, facing the fiber input, and then cover it up like that. So let's go ahead and see what it looks like. Okay, let's go ahead and run this. Here we go. From now on, I'm not going to show you the whole thing running, because not to waste your time. We're just going to look at the final spectrum of different things. Make this put this a little bit toward the center. There you go. So you can see that it doesn't have much content near blue. It's beginning to pick up a little bit near the green, and it's going to go up, and we'll see after when it's finished. So you can see most of its energy is contained above 600 nanometer, which makes sense because that's the color we were seeing with our eyes also. And then it's going to drop as the wavelength gets into the infrared. Now we are in the infrared, and it does this really interesting thing. So it has another peak into the infrared, but certainly above 820 nanometers. So you can see that in the visible range, most of its energy is in this region, and that's why when you look tight on the camera, the color that you were looking at was, you know, orangish color, which is a combination of these wavelengths to the human eye. And it has a peak in infrared, which of course we cannot see, very little energy in the blue region, and that's why it looks the way it does. So that's it, pretty interesting, and to see that this is the kind of shape we get. Again, this has to be corrected for the photomultipliers, sensitivity versus wavelength and so on, which I'm not doing. This is just giving you some idea of the spectral content. Here's the next subject of interest. This is just a white LED. To me, it looks really, really white. I'm not sure how warm it is, but it looks like a nice white color to you. It might look a little bit bluish on camera, but it is a white LED. So let's go ahead and see what it looks like. And here's the spectral content of our white LED. You can see that it is rather composite in wavelength, and it has all the colors essentially, which gives it, of course, the impression of looking white. And the shape of it is very interesting. And if you know, I did a quick couple of different searches to find an image to show you to compare to this as an example. For example, here I have just picked up some basic white LED, and look at that, the shape looks exactly the same. Now, in one of my previous videos, I did briefly talk about the semiconductor materials going into the LED. Of course, the white LED is a very composite semiconductor material made of many different type of dopants, and you can see here, for example, the wavelengths around blue can be achieved by gallium nitride or indium gallium nitride type material, and then this portion of the spectrum is made by yttrium aluminum type of material, which of course combined together gives you the white LED. And if you want to have more red content and infrared content. For that, you can use something like aluminum, gallium, nitride, indium phosphide type combination material to get that type of wavelength. But it's pretty interesting to see that we get a pretty good agreement to a basic white LED spectral content, and it looks pretty nice, and you can see why it would appear as white to our eyes. So as the last thing to measure, I just measured the ambient light in my room, which is a mercury vapor fluorescent light bulbs that I have all over the room, and you can see it is quite a complex spectrum, as to be expected. I've done this before when I was in university a long time ago, and you can actually identify each of those peaks to have a particular association with the physical properties of a fluorescent light bulb. And I don't want to get into the detail of that too much, but it's pretty cool to look at all the different types of wavelengths that are present, you know, even including in the ultraviolet, as to be again to be expected from the mercury vapor light, but it's very weak, of course. And you can see the different tones and different peaks here, and you know, if you zoom in here, for example, you can see there's actually a composite. There's more going on here than it seems. And if I just open, you know, randomly just grab spectrum from the web of a fluorescent light bulb, look at that. Isn't that amazing? It's exactly like what it should be. Every little tiny one of those peaks can be identified and can be associated with a specific type of a phenomena that's happening in there. And I don't want to go into the detail of that, but anyhow, as a whole project, I think it's fairly successful. And I think it's turned out pretty well. And I guess what I would like you guys to do, give me some feedback. If you like the video, please give it a thumbs up and leave some comment, and let's have an interesting discussion going on. And if you have other suggestions that I can do to this and improve it and modify, this is just the beta, or the alpha, I should say, prototype. So let me know, and I'll see you next time.